Some of these, one of the question is that why Newton's law is said to be a law and D'Alembert's principle is a principle. Even what I have learnt, I probably won't be able to give you the fantastic answer, but what I have learnt that law can deviate, but a principle can't. So what it essentially means that if you look at Newton's law, it depends on what reference frame you are choosing, okay? That means if I say force equals to mass times acceleration and I look at a frame that is moving with the body, then I don't think Newton's law can be held there. So that law violates. That means depending on the frame you are analyzing, you have to say resultant force equals to mass times acceleration in that direction, okay? But D'Alembert's principle, as we started, it's a principle because it is valid, in any moving frame that you see. That means as long as we say that MA is taken in an opposite manner, the body is at rest, so it does not violate. So it is, in any non-inertial frame, if we choose, then that principle will not be broken down. You have also seen that Newton's law is not valid when the speed of light, let's say, your speed is very high comparable to the light, then there are some violations there also. So principle is something that I learned that some others, theorem is derived from those principles. There is no violation to the principle. For example, why principle of transmissibility? That was another question. Why do we say transmissibility is a principle? Remember, the concept is that as long as equilibrium is concerned, a force can be taken anywhere in its line of action. And there is no violation to that. You can't violate that no matter what you do. So a principle cannot be violated, but a law, there may be deviations. Okay, so that's all I can answer at this moment. But if I do get a better answer from other experts, I will convey that to you. Okay? So other issues, I don't think there are many relevant questions that are coming up. If we merge this system in any fluid whose density is d, then what effect of the fluid on this system, please explain. I don't know the answer. I can only tell you that, okay, probably when we are dipping it, that means there is a resistance from the fluid. So fluid is entering, in the equation of motion, you only get that in terms of the damping force, viscous force. So fluid friction is going to come into play. And that we are going to, look at in the next half, this half as well. So that will be damped vibration. Think of a piston. Just think of a piston. Okay, and that is, let's say, on a cylinder, that piston, is going into the cylinder, and that cylinder is basically filled with fluid. What happens? You will have the, you will have the friction force that is coming as a resistance as the piston is trying to go down. Now, from the experiment, we have observed that force, the resistant force, is proportional to the velocity of the piston, okay? Other question, what is the, please specify the reference books for dynamics and vibration. I don't think for engineering mechanics course, our books, set of references are fixed. As we said that good book, if you want to see, definitely there are two, as we have referred to, Beer and Johnston and Merriam and Craig. So these are the two books, Beer and Johnston and Merriam and Craig. In both cases, in fact, we find that dynamics is more than that of statics. So now there are other questions coming up. What is the difference between oscillation and vibration? Vibration is more general. Oscillation is very specific. Okay. So anything oscillate, that means we try to say it is always going from positive to negative. But in vibration, it is not necessary that it will always go from some positive to some negative. Okay, so that is one of the questions. Now, I think how to account inertia forces for the body under motion, I think that is what we are covering. Okay, inertia force is again a resistance to the motion, and it has to be taken in an opposite way. Okay. So let us, there will be questions that is coming up. I am looking on to this, but let's try to, as such, I don't see everything is crystal clear in terms of the problems look like. There was a question in this problem. I think the problem number was, yes, so this problem, I think why this force was taken up here, someone said it should be down. Just look at it carefully, okay? So XA is chosen to be greater than XD. That means there is a net tension in the spring. If there is a tension in the spring, then how it should act? Okay, so we are analyzing this problem. We have assumed the fact, let's say XA is greater than XD. It does not matter. Just because of that, we are deriving the equation of motion based on that particular notion that, okay, I have XA and then XD is coming into play. XA is greater than XD. Therefore, I have a tension in the bottom spring. So how does tension will be from the spring is going to come to the body? It should be upward, okay? Similarly, if you look at the spring, this is also under tension. Spring under, tension at B as well. So how the body is going to see the force? Newton's third law. So Newton's third law is coming into play, okay? So it is going to be downward. So I don't see any problem as such. Is that clear now? Okay? So that is more relevant towards what I studied. Okay? Now what we'll do, we'll try to solve few tutorial problems before we go to the damped vibrations, and we can do the damped vibration as a separate study. And as long as we grasp this concept, I think there is not much issue to deliver these concepts to the students. Okay? So all I said or all we have learned is the fact that we can represent the body in an equivalent static system, okay, by using the D'Alembert's principle, which states that the inertia forces should be taken in an opposite manner. That means mass times acceleration and I times alpha, they should be taken in an opposite sense on the body. And then you can solve that problem at any instant of time t, okay, by using the equilibrium. That means resultant force should be 0 and resultant moment should be 0. That's all we have done, okay? But it's a very systematic and thorough procedure. And we have found that students actually enjoy doing that without getting into a lot of nitty-gritty of dynamics as such. So what with this, I think what we'll do, we'll try to go to the damped vibration, but I won't spend much time on that, maybe 15 minutes or so, because as such, we don't, also in the syllabus of IIT, it's not there. As you have seen, the main objective is to deliver the concept of drawing the free body diagrams. That is what we have been drawing from the beginning. How to draw the free body diagram, how to show the forces. And in this dynamic problem, I have simply said, okay, using this principle, we are looking at an equivalent static system. So let's now look at the damped free vibrations. The first statement that is being given is all vibration are damped to some degree but by forces due to dry friction, fluid friction or internal friction. Okay. it has to be damped, because we know that a system cannot oscillate for infinite long time. So, amplitude is going to decay and it is going to stop at some point of time. So, now here basically we have to represent this, you know, how the damping is coming into play. So, again it is a viscous damper or a dashpot. So, remember this piston is going into a cylinder which is of has some fluid which has a viscosity. So, if it is water and if it is, let us say, some honey, the viscosity will be different, and all of us know that. Therefore, what is going to happen, that one will, honey will give more resistance than that of water, as simple as that. Now, experimental evidence shows for small motion, the force that the body sees is going to be proportional to the velocity, and that proportionality constant is called to be damping coefficient C, which is a known. Okay? Now, you look at the equilibrium of this mass with the dashpot. If we just think of the free body diagram of this entire thing as it is isolated from the spring, again we are measuring the vibration from static equilibrium configuration. The mass is displaced by x, or let us say some x 0, and released. Okay? So, it is going to oscillate like this about the equilibrium configuration. So, at any instant of time x, at any instant of time t, displacement is x. So, what is the forces? Now, what are the forces acting on that? That is k delta s t plus x, that is the spring force, mass times acceleration, that is the inertia force, w c x dot. Okay. Remember, this w is actually equals to k times delta s t. So, that is going to go away ultimately. So, what we will end up getting is m x double dot plus c x dot plus k x. Okay. Now, I have to solve this equation of motion. So, idea is that, okay, we substitute for x equals to e to the power lambda t, assume the solution in this form and dividing through the e to the power lambda t. So, ultimately this is going back to the maths. So, we have, remember, x double dot, that will be what? Lambda square e to the power lambda t. X dot is simply lambda e to the power lambda t, right, and k x. So, ultimately this cannot be 0, because then we are not solving any problem. So, e to the power lambda t cannot be 0. So, we can divide this entire thing by that one for non-trivial solution. So, for the non-trivial solution, we have the characteristics equation that is displaced. So, it will have two roots, right. So, roots are like this. Now, what we have defined here, we are defining a damping, you know, critical damping coefficient such that this is equals to 0. Okay. So, in that way, what will happen? I will have the value of the critical damping coefficient, that is 2 m square root of k over m, that is 2 m omega n. Clear? Okay. Now, what it will do, ultimately once I know C c, let us say, that is the critical damping coefficient. Remember, if C c by 2 m, ultimately you have to always look at this, if that is greater than omega n, or if that is less than omega n, that is the whole idea, or if that is equals to 0. So, ultimately your roots of these equations are changing. Okay, so, we will write it in a bit different form. So, ultimately look how I have written it. I will define rather a damping ratio, which is xi. Xi is equals to what? C by C c. Now, C c is already given, 2 m omega n. Therefore, now lambda can be expressed in terms of xi, that is the damping ratio, and the omega n. Okay. So, negative xi omega n plus minus I omega n square root of 1 minus xi square. So, I will write the two roots in that form. Clear? Just by defining this damping ratio. Okay. Now, what is happening therefore? I can have three different situations. First one is xi less than 1. If xi is less than 1, that means C is less than CC. That is, C is less than the critical damping. We will call that underdamped system. Okay? So, in case of that, remember I have a positive I and negative I. Two roots are given by exactly what is shown. And therefore, we can say that we have the general solution in this form. Remember this, therefore, what will happen, that omega d is coming into play, that is damped circular frequency of vibration. Therefore, you are going to get an periodicity of omega d, sin omega dt plus cosine omega dt. So, this is basically the math, and here you are have a decaying term, e to the power minus c by 2 m is what? Xi omega n. Don't forget, c by 2 m is simply xi omega n. That is my damping ratio. Okay. So, ultimately, I am going to get my general solution in this form. Now, I have to solve for C1 and C2, which can be done depending on the problem. Let us say we are talking about a free damped vibration, then this C1 and C2 can be obtained based on the information on the initial conditions. Okay. So, that means whether at t equals to 0, I have x 0, at t equals to 0, I have v 0. So, that is underdamped system. What is critical damping? When xi is equals to 1, that means c is equals to cc. So, xi is equals to 1. Therefore, what happens? You can see clearly, if we go back to the math, therefore, you have c 1 plus c 2 t to the power minus omega n t. That is the solution. Okay. Right? And then third one will be xi is greater than 1. Now, if xi is greater than 1, you are going to get real roots. Okay? So, therefore, again we are going to get a solution of this form. So, this is called overdamped system. So, what we have now learned, that I have xi less than 1, xi equals to 1, or xi greater than 1. Three situations can happen. And for each one of these, my solution is bound to change just because of the property of the roots. So, that is the, you know, done in the, it is assumed that it is already done in the differential equation class. Now, let us take the damped vibration. As I was saying, so we are just trying to understand the physical, you know, nature, how I am going to get my solution, rather than going to the math. So, what is displayed is a comparison between a damped case and an undamped case. Undamped case we have already studied, right? Now, in the damped case, how do I get my solution given that I have x 0 and v 0 as my initial condition? That will be the complete solution. Remember, what will happen? If I assume x 0 equals to sin phi and this quantity as cosine phi, then I can express is again sin omega d t plus phi, and with a rho here, that rho is going to be the amplitude. So, there is again an amplitude of vibration, right? Remember that amplitude of vibration, if v 0 equals to 0, still has the xi. In this case, it is an undamped situation, if v 0, 0, it becomes x 0. So, now let us try to plot these two equations. As I said, please replace this figure by saying u equals to x. So, displacement is x, velocity at t equals to 0 is x 0, displacement at t equals to 0 is x 0 and velocity at t equals to 0 is v 0. Just replace, ok. So, I have x displacement this way and time this way and I am comparing an undamped system that is a faint line and damped system that is a bold line. So, what is happening? Ultimately, as expected, we can see that the damped system is actually decaying in the amplitude. And what is that envelope of the decay? That envelope of the decay is completely driven by rho multiplied by e to the power xi omega n t. Okay. That is the first thing. Therefore, there is a decay in the motion and there is an envelope that controls that decay. Clear? Second feature. What is the second feature you think? What essentially xi would do for an underdamped system? What is the effect on the time period? So, I have tau d, right, and tau n. Don't you think that time period of oscillation, a time period of vibration is going to increase when you have presence of xi? Of course, the motion is going to get slowed down, right. So, it is going to take more time to come back to the original configuration or equilibrium configuration than that of the undamped case when you have no damping. So, there is going to be a small increase in the time period of oscillation and you can show that also. We can clearly see that omega d equals to omega n square root of 1 minus xi square. So, therefore, the time period T d is equals to, that means damped time period equals to the undamped time period divided by square root of 1 minus xi square. So, for xi less than 1, here we are talking about xi less than 1 everywhere, your time period of vibration is going to increase a little bit depending on the value of xi. Remember, xi still has to be greater than, less than 1. Okay. So, depending on the xi, time period will definitely increase. Now, there is an interesting thing going on. How about if I take two successive peaks of the damped system? Let us say I know the amplitude here and let us say I know the amplitude here. Can I get a relationship directly between these two amplitudes? Answer is yes, because this envelope is controlled by rho e to the power minus xi omega n t, right. Now, the difference between these two peaks, what is the time difference? Capital T d, right, that is the time period. So, therefore, if you take the ratio, I will have x 1 divided by x 2 should be equals to e to the power xi omega n multiplied by the time period. Okay. So, now, what is happening? If we look at from the logarithmic point of view, you take the log of this, then ultimately I have xi omega n T d. So, T d can be expressed in terms of T n and T n can be expressed in terms of 2 pi by omega n. So, ultimately you see I have 2 pi xi square root of 1 minus xi square. So, we say it is a logarithmic decrement between the two amplitudes. Okay, so, if we know the successive amplitude, then you can, measuring the successive amplitudes, we can in principle calculate what is the xi, that means the damping ratio, and therefore, what is the damping coefficient C? Clear? So, physically if we look at, now we can actually solve problems through this concept, but before that I will show one more thing, that okay, what happens xi equals to 1 and xi equals to 2. So, let us say critically damped, that means xi equals to 1, and critically overdamped, that means let us say xi is greater than 1, so we assume xi equals to 2. What it does? Now, all of these, remember, we can simply take an Excel file, or let us say we take help of MATLAB, okay. We take help of MATLAB and we can plot this type of graphs, what is t versus displacement, right, time versus displacement graph. Now, this graph is given in terms of velocity equals to 0. The initial condition is at time t equals to 0, I have velocity 0. That means, slope of this curve should be 0. Velocity 0 means at time t equals to 0, the slope of this curve should be equals to 0. No initial velocity. Only thing I have is an initial displacement. That initial displacement is x 0. So, it is a normalized curve and we can do that. Ultimately, what is the outcome? Remember, this is a vibratory motion. So, it is an oscillation, right? And what happens to this? This is non-vibratory motion, both for critically damped and overdamped, as if they are not going to, you know, as you, let us say, you think of this door, that door has a dashpot right here, and you open the door, so you are giving it some theta, right? And you are releasing this door. What it does? It is designed in such a way, the damping is in such a way that xi is either equals to 1 and greater than 1. That means door is not going to go back to its equilibrium. Okay, so it is not going to go back to the other side and then again come back. So, in absence of this, what will happen if you release? It is simply going to hit you and again come back. Okay, that is the whole idea. So, to prevent that, okay, I am not going to get hit by opening this door. So, therefore, what is going to happen? You simply open the door and leave it. It is going to come back and stop at its equilibrium configuration. So, very nice example to look at. So, how do we solve these equations? I am leaving it to math, because that is basically mathematics, not going into the details. But what is most important to coming back to its equilibrium configuration, right? It is taking more and more time, because time period of vibration is naturally elongated. Is that clear now? So, I think with that, I will just give a very quick example of that of a loaded railroad car, let us say that is weighing 30,000 pounds, it has a mass, let us say, is rolling at a constant velocity and it couples with a spring and dashpot bumper system. Okay? So, it is moving at a constant velocity. Now, this, let us say, has a negligible mass. So, what is happening? Basically, this momentum is going to come to here. So, ultimately, it is going to get an initial velocity. You have already learned the conservation of momentum, right? So, ultimately, this is going to be transferred because this mass is going to be attached. So, this system, mass damper, you know, a spring damper system is going to get an additional mass with a velocity v 0 at time t equals to 0. So, your problem starts now. So, what happens? Let us assume that there is a recording device that is measuring the displacement, and the displacement is measured like this. Okay? Determine the damping constant and the spring constant. Look how nice this problem is. I have a recorded data, and from that I am trying to determine what is the spring constant and what is the damping constant required. Okay? So, again, since I know these successive peaks, So therefore, I can simply use the concept of logarithmic decrement, right. So in the next slide, first of all, we know, let us say, what is the time period of vibration to complete one cycle, that is TD, that is 0.41 second, that is given. I can calculate what is omega D. Okay. Now look at the logarithmic decrement, x1 by x2 should be e to the power xi omega n td. So therefore, e to the power c by 2 m td, right. So ultimately, I know this ratio x1 by x2, right. So therefore, I can calculate what is the c, because m is also known. So c can be calculated, and therefore, we can go to omega d expression that has k and m, both k, m and c, right, and from that I can calculate the k. Okay. So ultimate idea is, we do not get into lot of mathematics as such. Now what is happening, we can think of forced vibration, we solve the differential equation and so on so forth. But ultimately, you know, in this particular morning session, we have delivered the concept of single degree of freedom system. We have looked at what is generalized single degree of freedom system. We have introduced the concept of D'Alembert's principle to get the equations of motion for this system. And therefore, we have also looked at, can I solve this type of system for free undamped and free damped vibrations. And we have looked at some of the, you know, applications, physical applications that are actually possible. Okay? So I think with that, what I will do, I will conclude this session.